Yaris. Yeah.
I cannot wait for this ride. Modern classic, this apparently. So I've got a spec sheet here. Hang on. Wait. Hybrid. 116 horsepower. What? Hang on. This isn't the
Grr.
Yaris. This is just some little eco runabout.
Oh, what a disaster. That's my whole Sunday ruined.
There is hope, though.
But before we find out why that is, there just isn't an easier or more cost-effective way of getting into a new car than leasing with Vanarama. Click the link at the top of the screen or Google Vanarama to find your new lease of life. Maybe watch the video first, though. And please hit subscribe to make sure you never miss the best car content on the internet. We're doing great.
Yeah, this isn't a fast Yaris, but then again, the GR Yaris isn't a fast Yaris either. It's a fast hatchback called Yaris, but actually loads of the GR has nothing to do with the eponymous runabout. For a start, the actual chassis and all the body panels are different. The GR might be a Yaris in name only, but the two cars look surprisingly similar, which is to say that the standard car looks surprisingly, well, awesome. Who'd ever have thought that a small Toyota hatchback, let alone one with the same name as this car, would turn up in 2020 looking so flared and focused? Because until now, the Yaris has arguably been small, cheap, and personality-free motoring for the masses.
This thing, though, it is mint. It's not
flawless shit,
but it is just as good as it looks. And best of all, and most importantly, in my opinion, it's not boring, and that's despite it being an eco car and capable of actual 80 miles per gallon.
Really, here's some pictographic evidence. And that was while just driving home, and not especially carefully, from a fuel use point of view, I mean, obviously. Through a canny bit of traffic on mixed 30, 50, and 70 mph roads. Now, as is becoming increasingly fashionable among small cars, you don't really get much drivetrain choice. In fact, you get a choice of just one, and it does need a bit of explaining. So, the petrol engine is a three-cylinder linked to an ECVT gearbox. That's ECVT.
Which means it's got an epicyclic gear set that's electronically controlled and de facto supports infinite gear ratios, ergo achieving maximum efficiency at all times.
In effect, it's always running the engine at optimum RPMs. And in addition, the drivetrain is always trying to use the battery and the electric motor as much as it possibly can. Now, it's not a plug-in hybrid, so the battery is being charged by brake energy recapture and the engine itself. But because an electric motor is far more efficient than a petrol engine, as in far more of the energy it generates gets transferred down to the wheels, you get much better efficiency overall. And hence, 80 miles per gallon on the way home from work.
You also get the benefit of electric motor responsiveness. Now the facts get a little muddy here because you'll see that the electric motor has a bit more torque than the petrol engine, but sadly the two don't combine to give you a massive amount of total pulling power, as is the case with the lads. Instead, when both power sources combine to drive the front wheels, it's the electric motor's peak torque that you're getting, but because you get that near instantly, then this feels very responsive, it feels quick. But around town, it has that sense of alertness that you want. It is just proper impressive, this thing. In fact, I would go as far as to say that this is pretty much the perfect drivetrain for a town car. It's peak runabout, really economical, really punchy at low speed, really quiet when you're not ragging it, which obviously you're not around the doors. It puts itself into electric only mode surprisingly frequently, and you therefore get some of the benefits of an electric car, but without any range anxiety or having to plug the thing in. It's mint.
But to write this off as just an eco car is not fair at all. The chassis is great.
We're doing great. Yeah, I never thought I would say this about a small Toyota hybrid, but this is genuinely good fun to drive. Really, it's got a dead responsive steering rack. It's got a dead responsive steering rack that has a sort of natural feel to it, but also is very light for around the doors. Hard balance to get right, that. And it combines that sharp turning with lots of grip, so it's fun. And it's always telling you where your grip levels are, so you can get the tires squealing a little bit at the front, but with a bit of confidence. It actually generally feels like it has a really wide track, this. It feels stable. And the driving position is brilliant with it. Classic good quality ergonomics. Sat low into the cabin, lots of adjustment for the steering wheel and the seat. You're in the car, not on it. And then at the same time, the ride quality has this exceptional blend of comfort and good body control and giving you feel. It feels complex. It feels like the suspension is doing a great job of sending as little up into the cabin as possible while still letting you know what's going on. It doesn't bounce a lot. It's not over firm. Toyota has set this car up well, because it's basically comfortable and it's responsive and it's quiet-ish. I'll come back to a couple of the little NVH problems in a second.
Ultimately, you can really feel the work that Toyota has done here to make this a more distinguished driving experience. Like how the chassis is all new and much stiffer than the old Yaris's. And while the wheelbase is longer and wider for added stability, the car itself is shorter, wider, and lower, all of which help make it look as striking as it does. Toyota has even set the driver's seat lower and made the seat tracks longer, which is transformative for the driving position, especially if you're on the taller side.
But the fact remains that in pure dynamic terms, the feel you get from the CVT gearbox is problematic. It's really nice and quiet at low speed, and it's far less obtrusive sonically at mid-load than you probably think it's going to be. Problem is, if you push the car, so say you've come off a roundabout and you're on a motorway slip road and you really need to get up to speed fast, it's still just grating. Listen. Once you're up to speed though, it's back to the good stuff, mostly. So the ride quality on the motorway is dead good. Again, really settled, nice. It has that elusive big car feel, you know, the way that you're sat with space around you and the car's not bouncing around loads. However, that feel is eroded a little bit by the noise you get at high speed. So there's quite a lot of wind noise going across the top of the screen somehow. Well, not somehow, it's because there's lots of wind hitting the screen. But also in this car, there's a bit of whistle from the B pillar, which is really annoying, really unexpected in a car that seemed built this well. So it's not flawless, right? But it's just very, very good in all situations.
Yeah, the quality thing is similarly impressive, but also with areas that you might want to improve a bit. Now, as usual with these Japanese things, it feels extremely well put together, well made.
All the knobs and the buttons feel good. They've got nice weight. There's no rattles. There's even a bit of soft touchy plastic here and there. Personally though, I do just wish that Toyota would shift its design direction very slightly away from the 1990s. It's just all a bit grey and bleak, and there's a bit too much going on. It's useful, there's a lot of nice spaces and platforms and stuff, and I guess there's a lot to look at, there's a lot to take in, but it really is the more is more approach to design, when we all know that a modern, clean aesthetic is the opposite of that. And Toyota doesn't quite do the depth of quality thing, the haptics thing, as well as it probably should. That's more of a feeling thing, but you know, the indicator stalks feel a bit naff. And despite what I just said about the buttons and the knobs, you kind of do want them to click a bit better than they do. And it's like when you close the door, it doesn't have a nice thunk as much as a clang, like a drunk lad hitting a lamppost.
But I'm sure you'll agree that the data is the most important stuff. The knowledge that your car is highly unlikely to break. Also, you'll like how much stuff this car has. Your basic spec, called Icon and possibly named in homage to the nightclub that that drunk lad fell out of. Lot of stuff here, right? A lot. This is one of those cars where the base model really does give you everything that you'll need.
Unless you need your stereo to sound good, because the four-speaker system in here absolutely sucks.
To sort out that little problem, you're going to have to jump past mid-spec, which is called design, and go either to XL trim, which gives you a couple of extra speakers, or ideally to dynamic trim, which is my favorite, not least because it gets a proper branded stereo upgrade by these guys.
Now you can enjoy a cool, refreshing breeze even on the hottest days with the incredible Chillmax Air from JML.
Oh wait, that's JML. Sorry, it seemed weird that. You may have noticed that something called Toyota Safety Sense 2, that's 4.2, is standard. Now, at the time the Yaris came out, Toyota claimed that this had the most comprehensive suite of electronic safety systems in the small hatchback class. And whether or not that's still the case today, this really does have more accident mitigation stuff in it than the Pampers factory. Joke about poo there. This is, of course, a five-star safe car.
Practicality then, now up here, kind of linked to what I said before, it does feel a little bit better than the average small runabout because of all the platforms and stuff, the places to put things. You probably won't use them, but it's nice to know that you can. Aside from those things, glove boxes are half decent size. There's a bit of storage in the center console and in this armrest. Door pocket, specifically for a bottle, but never a cup. It's a little picture that tells you that.
Good amount of leg space though, for a little one, although it does have quite a short wheelbase, so it's far from class-leading. Fiesta, Mazda 2, Clio 208 Corsa, they all have a longer distance between the wheels than this does.
But that's part of what helps this feel nice and compact. A proper town car, proper maneuverable, but also big enough. Good balance that. I think people will like how dinky this feels.
Same sort of thing with a boot. Again, a little on the smaller side for the class, but if you look closely, we're really only talking about a few liters. It's a perfectly serviceable and sizable boot. Twin floor, flat folding rear bench.
Such and such and such and blah, 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 blah.
And that's really it. This is great. It's comfy, it's fun to drive, it's really economical, it looks striking, it's well priced, it's just easily one of the best of these things. Standard question, is it better than the Fiesta? The answer is probably not, for me anyway, but it is very, very close, which is not something that you could say of any of the other Yaris's. Yari? Anyway, whatever you call the plural of a Yaris, they weren't anywhere near a Fiesta, that's for sure, and this is. I need that holiday, man.
And that's it. We've done great. Lease one of these from us if you want one. It really is the most cost-effective and just generally pleasant way of getting into one of these. Please subscribe to the channel, especially if we've held your attention for this long. It's the least you can do. Have a look at all of that stuff, and thanks again for watching. I'll see you soon. Cheers. Bye.